next on ABC7's Good Morning El Paso Weekend. More arrests and developments in the terror investigations in Europe as the latest city targeted remains on high alert. And a homeless teen now charged with murder in Texas after a UT student is found dead in the middle of campus. And the embattled head of the Doña Ana County Jail could soon be back on the job after new developments to the list of charges he was facing. This is all the news you need to start your Saturday, April 9th. ABC7's Good Morning El Paso Weekend starts right now.
Live, where news comes first. From the Mesilla Valley and Las Cruces to El Paso and the borderland. This is ABC7's Good Morning El Paso Weekend.
Good morning, El Paso, and thank you for joining us. I'm Andrew J. Polk. Police have arrested a woman who was added to the FBI's top 10 most wanted list just this week. 33-year-old Brenda Delgado was captured in Torreon, Mexico yesterday. She's accused of plotting the murder of her romantic rival. Police say she got her accomplices to kill a Dallas dentist who was dating her ex-boyfriend. Delgado is now facing capital murder charges. Delgado is the ninth woman to be added to the FBI's most wanted list since it was created in the 1950s. And 18 days after the Brussels terror attacks, the city remains under its second highest terror alert level. Authorities made multiple arrests recently, including five men detained yesterday accused of having links to the Brussels bombings. The latest arrest includes the last known fugitive in last year's Paris attacks. One suspect, Mohamed Abrini, could be the mysterious man in the hat who escaped the double bombing at the Brussels airport. But federal prosecutors there said they still needed further verification. Abrini's suspected role in the Paris attacks has never been made completely clear. He was seen in the attack convoy en route to Paris in the days ahead of the bloodshed, but disappeared afterward. A homeless teen is facing murder charges for the killing of a Texas student. A judge set a $1 million bond for a 17-year-old police say killed a University of Texas student right in the heart of campus. The Travis County judge signed an arrest affidavit yesterday that says, quote, there is sufficient probable cause to support the charge of murder against Mikhail Kreiner. An Austin police spokesman says Kreiner will face murder and perhaps other charges for the killing of first-year dance student Hakura Weiser. Weiser, an 18-year-old Oregon native, was last seen leaving the campus drama building Sunday night. Her body showed signs of assault and was found in a creek near the Alumni Center and football stadium. In response to the killing, university officials requested increased police presence on campus and are working with a state agency to review security.
Do you have any words for Sheriff Vigil?
On the advice of a good friend, I'm going to say this has been a character tester.
Chris Barrella, the jail director in Doña Ana County, could soon be back on the job as soon as Monday. Yesterday, we heard from him for the very first time since he was cleared of charges related to a fraud investigation. From our New Mexico Mobile Newsroom, Barrella was cleared last week of fraud and embezzlement charges surrounding the misuse of money meant for inmates. Thursday, a grand jury dropped a third charge of unlawfully taking a weapon into a jail. The DA's office says there was not enough evidence to move forward on any of those charges. ABC7's Josie Orthagon caught up with Barrella and the county manager after yesterday's hearing.
And how do you feel about getting back to work on Monday?
I'm extremely happy. I can't wait to get back into my chair behind my desk and see all my employees and start working.
How many more thousands of taxpayers' dollars have to be wasted in what seems apparently to be not the pursuit of justice, but the pursuit of personalities?
District Attorney Mark D'Antonio signed off on the arrest and search warrants, criminal complaints, and statements of facts. He even stood by Sheriff Kiki Vigil during a news conference soon after Barrella's arrest, seen here. So why wasn't his office able to move forward with prosecution? Patrick Hayes with the DA's office emailed ABC7 the following statement, saying, quote, there was enough probable cause to justify the filing of criminal charges. That's why we signed off. In regards to the contraband charge, we thought there was enough evidence to present that charge to a grand jury. Hayes goes on to say, however, we didn't think there was enough evidence to take the case to trial, and we respect their decision. And we have repeatedly reached out to Sheriff Kiki Vigil as well. He has been unavailable for comments so far. And our New Mexico Mobile Newsroom crew is following a series of pellet gun shootings in Las Cruces. Thursday night, someone shot out the windows on two cars on the 2800 block of Telshore. Then just down the block on Commerce Drive, pellets were shot in the direction of three LCPD officers. One of the officers was hit in the leg. Police say whomever was responsible could be charged with battery on a police officer. But finding the suspect may not be easy.
The There are several outlets from the parking lot where they believe these shots may have come from. There are several outlets onto Telshore, right across Telshore to the movie theater. Mm-hmm. They can go both ways on Telshore, obviously. And so it was the officers did not have time to, and of course it was dark also.
Las Cruces police are offering a $1,000 reward for information that leads to an arrest in this case. You can call 1-800-222-TIPS. That's the number there on your screen, 1-800-222-8477. You can also text that number there on your screen by a tip by text message. And all of this comes just a few days after three Coronado High School cross-country runners were shot at with a pellet gun in West El Paso. The El Paso Sheriff's Office is asking for your help in finding a wanted suspect. 19-year-old Sapphire Marie Armenta is wanted for a probation violation and burglary of habitation. Deputies have not said when she was last seen, but if you have any information or have spotted her, you are asked to call the Sheriff's Office at 915-566-TIPS. That's the number there at the bottom of your screen, 915-566-8477. And the young man accused of driving drunk and killing two of his passengers is now waiting to hear his sentencing from the judge. 19-year-old Adrian Dominguez pleaded guilty to two counts of intoxication manslaughter yesterday. Before facing the judge, Dominguez had to face the relatives of the victims as he walked into the courtroom. In May of last year, Dominguez was driving a car with three other teens as his passengers. He lost control of the car on Zaragoza near the Isleta port of entry. The car hit a guardrail and the impact launched it over a canal. The vehicle then rolled and caught fire. Dominguez and one passenger were able to escape. However, 17-year-old Jacob Salazar and 18-year-old Eric Dominguez died on the scene.
For the one who is drunk, contemplating getting behind the wheel, don't do it. You ruin so many lives, you don't even know what can happen.
The judge will also take a closer look at Adrian Dominguez's background and should come back with a punishment within the next 2 months. Getting to your storm track weather now. Many are waking up to a soggy borderland this morning. So let's get your first forecast with storm tracker Iris Lopez. She's live right now at the fountains at Farrah for Walk for Wishes. Good morning, Iris.
Good Saturday morning. We are out here at the Fountains of Farrah for a great, great event. It is the first annual Walk for Wishes, and right now, actually, one wish was granted. Elijah got himself the puppy he always wanted. It was granted live on stage. You can hear them already getting the festivities started. Our very own Rick Cabrera is the MC for the day. Now, the whole race is going to start in a bit. They're going to be lining up right here, right behind me. We'll talk a little bit more to some wish kids and some families, but let's talk about weather right now. They're going to head outside. It's going to be a bit chilly, but don't worry. Those temperatures are going to slowly but surely start to warm up a bit. Look at those temperatures across the region and here in El Paso and Las Cruces. Our forecast for this morning, your breakfast forecast, 59 by 9 o'clock, sunny skies. Then we're going to jump into those 70s by noon, your lunchtime hour. Today, later on, we are going to have to deal with those winds. Upper breezy category, though. Peak wind gusts west-southwest at 25 miles per hour. We can expect them 11 a.m. through your 9 o'clock hour. Coming up today, sunny and breezy. What about tonight? Are those winds going to increase and continue? Plus, we are going to fast forward to the week ahead to see what is in store and how you can plan your day. But for now, we're out here enjoying a very, very fun event for a good cause, and we'll talk more about it coming up later. Andrew?
All right, thanks, Iris. Check back with you in just a bit. In the meantime, though, City Rep Loretta Romero stepped down this past December, citing health reasons. At the time, his wife told ABC 7 Romero suffered a stroke. Even though he resigned, state law mandates Romero remained on holdover status until his seat is filled, meaning he's still getting paid. City Rep Claudia Ordaz hopes to soon put an end to that.
We got a briefing at our last meeting that within our charter, we actually do have that authority. If a member of council has three unexcused absences, council at that time has an opportunity to revoke the pay.
What Ordaz was even more upset about was seeing these pictures of Romero at the Masters this week on his son's Facebook page. Local blogger Jamie Ibetia also posted this pic of Romero boarding a plane on Tuesday. City Rep Dr. Michael No has been one of Romero's biggest supporters through his illness.
Of due process throughout the whole process, that's all.
Does it change your thinking now at all, knowing that he's gone to the Masters?
Well, the impression now is that he is able to get about and function at a fairly high level. So yes, I would have to say it does.
No says he's unsure if he will vote not to excuse Romero's absence at the next meeting, but he did say that he thinks either Romero should start attending the meetings or give up the salary. Romero's son told ABC7's Darren Hunt that the trip to the Masters was a present for his dad's 60th birthday. And both El Paso and UTEP are raising student tuition. ABC7 looked into what's causing the tuition hike. Public colleges get their money from the state, property taxes, and tuition, and it's the state that is financially delivering less and less, hurting public colleges across Texas. ABC's Ashley Rodriguez has the story.
State funding has somewhat eroded, and so more and more we're having to look at tuition.
El Paso Community College trustees are asking students to start paying between $10 to $15 more per credit hour. At UTEP, in-state students will pay more than $160 per semester, out-of-state around $450.
In light of the fact that we were decreased last year, $3.2 million in state funding, we feel like it is necessary for us to look at tuition as an avenue to raise revenue.
This stems from Texas's own financial shortfall, the multi-billion dollar hole, and legislators who are wary of raising taxes chose to balance the budget by cutting funding from different programs. This included slashing more than $5 billion from public education, impacting the schools here in El Paso.
I think it's already a lot right now.
I think that I would like for them not to raise tuition, but it's already pretty cheap.
I feel like if you're going to increase the tuition, like, what is it going to go towards? Is it going to go towards the students?
Both UTEP and EPCC tell ABC7 raising tuition in light of the cuts in state funding is necessary to maintain academic programs and competitive salaries for faculty.
The message would just be that it is an investment, and this is something that's going to be extremely valuable for them when they receive that degree.
And that was Ashley Rodriguez reporting. In the case of nearby NMSU, the board there chose to make cuts rather than raise tuition. And if you haven't gotten your ticket for Neon Desert yet, listen up. GECU is having a student discount sale today. Right now, tickets for the Music Fest start at $120, but if you bring your student ID, you can get the tickets for $100, but make sure to bring it in cash. The tickets will only be available from 12 p.m. to 4 p.m. at the 987 block of Rojas and at 7410 Helen of Troy. Tickets are limited, so if you're interested, make sure to get there as soon as possible. There's a limit of 2 tickets per person. And of course, don't forget to pick up your copy of the El Paso Inc. In this week's issue, you'll find how the city is cracking down on dangerous buildings in downtown as building inspectors go block by block. Also, what are City Manager Tommy Gonzalez's new marching orders from City Council? Only El Paso Inc. has the 20-page document. And get a sneak peek inside a new design store opening up in El Paso with an emphasis on quality and craftsmanship. El Paso Inc. is online at elpasoinc.com and available for home and business delivery. Call the number there at the bottom of your screen, 534-4422, to subscribe. And we're definitely seeing some April showers here in the borderland, but coming up on Good Morning El Paso Weekend, how other parts of the country are seeing April snow instead and celebrating it. And later, a man escaped from a psychiatric hospital after allegedly torturing a woman to death. It is 8:13 right now, taking a live look at traffic this morning. This is I-10 in Hawkins, and this is the exit, an area you'll have to drive through if you want to make it to that Walk for Wishes. We checked in with Iris earlier, and all that going on right now, so plenty of time to go and check out all the fun. You're watching ABC7, where news comes first.